Hi, good evening, everyone, and welcome to what is our last lecture of the 2014 season here at the Aquarium. And before we start, I just want to acknowledge the support that we receive from the Lowell Institute that allows the Aquarium to offer these programs. And we're very grateful for their support and for you all coming out this evening. And also a special thanks to the WGBH Forum Network, who they filmed tonight's lecture and make it available on the web so that you can see it again if you want, or share it with your friends and family. So my name's Tim Werner. I'm a research scientist here at the New England Aquarium. And I first heard about our speaker tonight when I was part of a group convened by the International Whaling Commission looking at the impacts of plastics on marine mammals. And, you know, plastics in the ocean environment, of course, take many shapes and forms, as we're all very sadly aware. Very large things, big giant nets and traps and fishing traps and plastic bottles, but also very, very tiny things that are micrometers wide, and tiny things that are put into toothpastes and other things that we all use on a daily basis. It's a huge issue, and the gentleman who I'm introducing tonight, Dr. Mike Biddle, is really at the forefront of this issue worldwide. So Dr. Biddle started a company, MBA Polymers, over 20 years ago, literally from his garage in California, like all great startups. And before starting the company, he had a lot of experience in several multinational companies, including GE and Dow. The company has grown so that it now has operations, state-of-the-art plants in China, in Austria, and also the UK. The company currently has a processing capacity of over 300 million pounds per year of mixed plastic-rich waste, which he'll talk some more about. Some of our largest manufacturers in the world that use plastics use a product that comes from MBA and to replace virgin plastics in their new products. Mike's received numerous international awards for his work, which he'll tell you some more about, and because there's so many to list here and I really want us to get to his talk. But they include the 2012 Gothenburg Award, which an award he shares with Al Gore and Kofi Annan, as well as the 2010 Economist Innovation Award. Mike has a BS in chemical engineering from the University of Louisville and a PhD in polymer science and engineering from Case Western Reserve University, both which he achieved with high honors. And he was also a Sloan Fellow at Stanford University's Graduate School of Business in, I won't tell you what year. So this is truly an inspirational talk. You're wise to come out and listen to it. I think you're going to get a lot out of it. So with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Biddle.
Well, first let me thank you for coming out in this holiday season and somewhat inclement weather. Of course, I know this is pretty easygoing weather for New England. Coming from California, though, I got a nice awakening to some snow this morning. I actually appreciate it. It was nice to see. And I was fleeing from a big storm on the West Coast, so I left my family dealing with actual flooding down our street, I heard, later today. I'm going to be talking, as is Tim, thank you for the nice introduction, Tim, about my journey over the last 20 years of trying to turn literally waste into something of value, how I did it, why I did it, and the implications it has, particularly on our oceans, which are so important to us, and I assume that's why many of you are here today and why we're speaking here at the Aquarium. That journey will include MBA Polymers, which is the company I founded 20 years ago that Tim talked about, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that during the presentation. And also my more recent company I just started called Material Solutions, where I'm out working with organizations like the great folks here that work at the Aquarium, trying to figure out how to de-waste our oceans and make them healthy again. You know, our oceans are under a lot of stress, and just one of the many stresses they're under is the huge amount of waste we've dumped on them over the decades. And that's one of my new missions in life, is trying to figure that out, and hopefully through my presentation you'll understand why that's so important. I'd like to start off the talk talking to you about your stuff, the stuff in your life. And I'd like to start at the beginning. Think back when you were a toddler. Now, that was a long time ago for me, but I'm a late starter in life, and I've got two young kids, so I've been reintroduced to toddler rules. This is my son, who's a little bit older now. He's 9 now, and he's always got multiple toys in his hand still today. And his rules go something like this. It's my stuff if I saw it first. The entire pile is my stuff if I'm building something. The more stuff that's mine, the better. And of course, it's your stuff if it's broken. So after spending over 20 years walking through garbage piles around the world and trying to get something out of them, it's not clear to me that we leave these toddler rules behind as we develop into adults, or as our countries, quote, develop into developed countries. And let me tell you why I have that perspective. One of the reasons is every single day at our facilities around the world, we handle over 1 million pounds of people's discarded stuff. Now, 1 million pounds a day sounds like a lot of stuff, and it is a lot of stuff. But it's like a grain of sand on a beach compared to how much stuff we discard around the world each and every day. United Nations estimates that just e-waste alone, electronics waste, anything with a cord or battery, represents over 85 billion pounds a year, and it's one of the fastest growing parts of our waste stream. I think we all know why, right? We probably have 2 or 3 electronic gadgets with us this evening. If you put in other durable goods that we take for granted, that number more than doubles. And these things eventually reach end of life, and they look like this, or they look like this. And the piles, these piles, of course, are bigger in developed countries, but in developing countries, they're starting to grow very quickly. The McKinsey, a very large research institute, estimates that we will have 3 billion new middle-class consumers hit the planet in just the next 15 years. We all know about population growth, but the bigger impact on this type of issue is the consumption growth. And who are we to say they can't enjoy the same tools and toys we take for granted every day? 3 billion new people wanting the same stuff that we populate our homes and lives with. Now, when that ends life, it often ends up like this, and we think of it as garbage. Now, when we see these piles of end-of-life stuff, we see above-ground mines. And the reason we see mines is because a lot of valuable materials went into making this stuff in the first place. One of those materials is metal and minerals. And we're going to more extreme conditions to get and mine those metals and minerals to make all of our new stuff. And of course, those 3 billion new consumers are going to want more and more of the same stuff. Those practices have both environmental and economic impacts. This is from the U.S. Geological Service. It shows that since 1997, the amount of discoveries of new metal and mineral discoveries of mines has gone down, and of course, as those discoveries go down, the cost of extraction and the cost of getting those materials goes up. So besides the environmental impacts, the clear environmental impacts, there are significant economic impacts with us demanding more stuff from the planet. The other material that we find in a lot of our stuff, this is an age test. Half the audience at least will know this scene from the 1960s movie, The Graduate. Dustin Hoffman was playing a recent college graduate, and this was a family friend, took him aside and whispered into his ear one word, and that one word was the future. What was the one word?
Plastics.
Right, so many of you passed the age test. Some of you are just sitting there, what? I don't remember that movie. We remember that, some of us remember that line from the movie, because it was a joke. Nobody in their right mind in the 1960s would have thought it was hip or cool to go in the chemical or plastics industry. But whoever put that line in the movie actually knew what they were talking about. This is the growth rate, that orange line, the one that you see going up so quickly, is the growth rate of plastic since that movie was released, roughly, compared to 2 other materials that plastic has replaced in many applications, steel and paper, just for reference. So we use a lot more metals to make our stuff, but we use even more plastics to make the stuff that's in our lives each and every day. In fact, I've got some of it sitting here in front of me. And that plastic is made from petrochemicals largely, either oil or gas. And the way we're going to get those natural resources to make plastics has economic and environmental implications as well, just like with the metals and minerals. So, are there better ways to get this material and get the materials we want for our stuff? Well, the metals industry has figured out a long time ago that it makes a whole lot more sense to reuse this metal again and again via recycling. So when your car ends life, it may, here in Boston, end up about 10 or 15 minutes from here at a car shredder. And that car shredder will tear your, shred your car into hand-sized, fist-sized pieces of metal and other materials in about 20 seconds per car. The materials, now that they're liberated and size reduced, the metals will be recovered, the steel, the aluminum, copper, and so forth to a large extent. And everything else is usually a byproduct that's put into your local landfill here in Massachusetts. And in fact, to put that in perspective, I'm using steel as a proxy for metals. Steel and most metals, when they reach particularly if they reach a recycling facility, will be recycled at well over 90, probably well over 95%. Plastics, the USA EPA reports that the plastics in the United States is recycled at only about 9%. And that number is even overstated, because that reflects the amount of material that's actually collected by your local recycling facility, much of it being shipped overseas for informal recycling, and only a portion of that is recycled, and I'll show you what happens to the rest in many cases. Now, many people think the reason for the low recycle rate for plastics, so there's this huge material, and there's a lot of it, but its recycle rate is so low, they think, well, that it has little value. That's why it's a throwaway material, not reused. But plastics are actually 3 to 4 to 5 times more valuable than steel on a price per weight basis. So if there's so much of this material, and it's so valuable, why in the world is its reuse and recovery rate so low compared to a much less valuable material? Well, the main reason is it's not easy. If it were easy, there'd be thousands of MBA polymers, my company's out there, just like there's thousands of metal recyclers around the world. And let me just kind of scratch the surface on why it's not easy. The main reason it's not easy to separate from other materials. If we compare it to metals, metals have very different densities over a fairly wide range. They have different electrical and magnetic properties, and they even have different colors. All of these property differences in the metals are exploited to separate them either from an ore in the ground or to separate them at end of life in a recycling scenario. Plastics, on the other hand, have overlapping densities over a very narrow range, and I'm only representing some of the plastics in the world up there. Their electrical and magnetic properties are either non-existent or very similar, and any plastic can be any color. So the traditional tools and technologies we use to separate materials from each other simply don't work for plastics, and we had to get very creative. I'll come to that. One of the implications of plastics being difficult to recycle and metals being easy to recycle is a lot of our complex waste streams, particularly those of us in the United States, we ship our, knowingly or unknowingly, ship our electronics waste and other difficult to recycle streams overseas for low-cost informal recycling. And people, for as little as $1 to $2 a day, pick through our waste streams, and they recover what they can recognize as having value, which is largely the metals, circuit boards, wires, and so forth, and they discard everything else, which is largely things like plastic housings and the leaded glass CRT tubes. I can show you hundreds of these pictures, but I think you get the idea. The circuit boards, they will harvest the components off the circuit boards because they have precious metals and there are some valuable components. These are open lead tin solder baths. You can imagine the fumes coming off these baths. Or they burn them in open air. And here they're burning away the plastic material to get to the metals. This is a wire bundle that they're burning. And the wire was mostly covered in PVC. The smoke coming off this will be heavy in dioxins, so very deadly. And in fact, some of it's quite formalized. These are called burn houses, and you can find these in certain parts of China, for example, where they've taken it to an industrial scale. They still use manual labor to feed the fires inside the burn houses, and they use manual labor to then harvest the metals that are then released from the burning of the plastics that encase the metals. Now, this is low-cost recycling, certainly, but it's not low-cost from a human health and safety standpoint, local ecosystem standpoint. It's not fair, and it's certainly not sustainable in the true sense of the word. China is indeed trying to crack down on this, and largely due to that crackdown, some of this type of practice of recycling has moved to other parts of the world, like Africa, like Malaysia, Indonesia, etc. Now, I've talked a lot about durable good plastics because that's actually where I started my adventure, but now we're doing packaging recycling, recycling packaging plastics, and the reason we're doing that is because there's so darn much of that in the world. In fact, there's about three times as much plastic in packaging, which has a very short lifetime, than there is in durable goods. And to help put that in perspective, I'm going to have Chris Jordan help me out with his artwork. Are any of you in the audience familiar with Chris Jordan's artwork? A few of you. Well, if you go to his website, you can get a better representation than I'm going to give you, but I'll just scratch the surface here. So what he does is he tries to put big numbers, big issues in perspective using art. And this is, I'll show you two examples. This is one where he's created what looks like a modern art type of structure. What he does, he actually builds the artwork and he takes pictures of it. If you zoom in on it, you can do this on a continuous basis on the website. I'm just going to show you three screenshots. You can see it's three-dimensional in nature, it goes pretty deep, it starts to look like an industrial scene, and you zoom in a little bit further and you see it's made up of little plastic cups. And in fact, how he built this structure was taking 1 million of these plastic cups to build it, which is equivalent to about how many plastic cups we use in the USA on just airline flights every 6 hours. Just in the USA every 6 hours. Makes me feel guilty drinking out of this plastic cup. Excuse me. One other example, T-Rex, I like this one. If you zoom in on T-Rex, we zoom in on his head here, get a little bit closer, and what he's made this sculpture out of is plastic bags. The type of grocery bags we just banned in California, by the way, single-use plastic bags. Here, he's used 240,000 plastic bags, which is his estimate of how many plastic bags are consumed around the world every 10 seconds. So this, sometimes artwork does indeed bring life to life, issues to life, and I think he does a good job with his artwork. Now, where does a lot of this stuff end its life? In developing countries, even sometimes here in developed countries, you'll find it on shorelines. In fact, I think one of these is in Hawaii. And I can show you some from the LA River as well. And this is not necessarily because they've littered it here on the shoreline, but they've littered it elsewhere in the tides and other practices that brought it on shore. Now, we often get asked, if it's so concentrated, then can't we recover these plastics? And indeed, people are trying to do that. There's actually water under this fellow's boat. Here's people wading through water. And what in each case, what they're typically doing is picking out one similar object. The fellow in the what you're looking at, lower left, is picking out PET, the clear PET bottles like a Coke bottle. And in the upper left, the fellow's picking out straws. And the reason they're picking out one item, it's their method of separating plastics. I have a PhD in plastics. I couldn't do a much better job than these guys. So basically, if it's the same shape, looks the same, there's a decent chance it's going to be the same plastic. They can then go back on shore and sell it and earn a living. Now, they're not going to solve the waste problem doing this, but they can sort of eke out a living. This is another example. This is in Mumbai, India. I took this shot standing on the slums. This is the largest slum in India. And this part of the slum is the plastic area part of the slum. And you can see plastic waste stored on the rooftops. You go under these rooftops, literally in hundreds of workshops, and you see people in there, between typically five or a dozen people, separating plastics by hand, and they're doing it by color, by feel, by shape, even the sound it makes when it lands on the ground. And they can do a decent enough job that they can make low-quality products from these sorted plastics. To determine how good a job they've done with their sorting, they often do what's called the burn and sniff technique. And I asked this young lady in Ningbo, China, to demonstrate it for me. I could literally show you hundreds of these photos as well. You light the piece of plastic on fire, you blow it out so that it smokes, and then you inhale the smoke. Now, every time I see this done, I say, please stop doing this, because it's not long-term healthy to do this. And the usual answer I get back is, oh, I don't do this, my workers do this. I'm just showing you how it's done. I said, well, you missed the whole point. They shouldn't be doing it either. But this is the tools they have available. This is your compact disc getting recycled. So compact discs are made from polycarbonate, which is a very valuable plastic, covered with a metal layer and then another layer of plastic. And they're using a caustic bath here to etch off the metal layer from the polycarbonate. And I asked the gentleman what he did with this vat once it was spent, and he took me around the curtain you see in the background, and he said, well, we dump it in this field here because that's the only alternative he has. And indeed, you can tell he'd been dumping these solutions in that field for some time. There's host cities that have grown up to handle our waste. This has been our predominant waste practice for difficult to separate waste. Now, the good news is there's actually people trying to get value from our waste streams. This happens to be a city in China. I'm not trying to pick on China, but China has been taking much of our waste, particularly our plastic waste and a lot of our metal waste, because they have a big need for it. They make a lot of the world's stuff. What they do the same thing that we do with our waste here when we first touch it. They pull out the stuff that a human or a machine can easily recognize, and that's what we call the ones and twos, the PET bottles and the polyethylene milk jugs and other polyethylene bottles. And they actually do a pretty good job with human labor doing that. Beyond that, it's very difficult for humans to separate out any more plastics, and the plastics often end up disposed of inappropriately. And inappropriately, in developing countries, often means the nearest ravine or the nearest river. And you might ask, oh my gosh, how could they do this? Why would they intentionally dump waste into streams? Well, the reason is because rivers and streams have this wonderful characteristic. They're self-cleaning. So you can put a big dump in today, and the river carries it away, and you can dump again tomorrow. You have a clean stream to dump in tomorrow. Now that away eventually is into the oceans. And once it hits the oceans, and by the way, you ask, how could they do this? Well, it's their version of NIMBY, not in my backyard, which is probably something many of you have heard about, right? How many of you want a garbage dump in your backyard? I didn't think I'd see many hands come up. I don't want a garbage dump in my backyard either. So it's their version of NIMBY. Our version of NIMBY looks like this. Our difficult to recycle waste, we put on a 40-foot container, we put on a shipping vessel. That shipping vessel carries it to a developing country where they handpick through it, as I've shown you in some of the slides. And what they can't recycle, they dispose of in ways that we would find hugely unacceptable in this country. So what's the difference between our NIMBY and their NIMBY? Ours is just a little bit further away, but the end result is often the same. So I think the biggest difference is that we actually have a choice. We can recycle this material if we just are willing to do it. And to put this in perspective, this issue of plastics in the ocean in perspective, this is a artwork at the Zurich Museum of Design. Let's see the laser pointer work. There's a woman standing on the left-hand side just for reference of size. That's a very big pile of plastic. And that's how much they estimate how much plastic enters the world oceans every 15 seconds. There was just a study that came out yesterday, as a matter of fact, and I think the number was, I need to actually go out and look at it, I just looked at it very briefly, on the order of some trillion number of pieces of plastic that they're estimating. 5+ trillion numbers of pieces, and over 300,000 tons just in a couple of the gyres out there in the ocean. Well, there's lots of problems with all that plastic ending up. The oceans are a big place, but there's lots of problems with it ending up in the oceans. And one of the many problems is that when it encounters sea life, it's usually not a good consequence. And many of you have probably seen some of these pictures. The one that astonishes me is that turtle in the upper right. I don't know how they could have grown up with that six-pack ring around its center. And you see a camel in the middle, so it's not just an ocean problem. I'm going to talk a little bit more. Again, I'm going to use some of Chris Jordan's great photography work to talk about the plight of the albatross, the largest albatross in the world, which nests on Midway Island. And in fact, let me share a little, before I do that, let me mention
but the outrage that this has caused. There's over 50 groups that I've identified that are trying to solve this problem, which is a very good thing. Their solution to this problem of plastics in the oceans is often just to ban plastics, and I certainly understand that reaction. The problem is plastics serve many beneficial uses in our everyday life, and I don't think we want those benefits to go away simply because we haven't managed our waste in a responsible way. So we'd be being given up huge advantages that plastics give us in many of our applications because we don't manage our waste properly. I don't think that's the right solution, but I certainly understand why that would be the reaction among many groups. And after you see this video, you may feel the same way. So let me just share a three-minute trailer for you that talks about the plight of these albatross on Midway Island.
Do we have the courage to face the realities of our time and allow ourselves to feel deeply enough that it transforms us and our future? Come with me on a journey through the eye of beauty. Across an ocean of grief. And beyond.
It's always little difficult for me to talk, even though I've seen that film so many times. I don't know how you can watch something like that and not be moved. If you want to share this with any of your friends, you can go to www.midwayfilm.com, and that trailer exists for the downloading or viewing. But there's literally tens of thousands of albatross that are being hit by this problem, and it's, I don't know if you noticed at the beginning, but it said Midway Island is 2,000 miles from the nearest coastline. There's only a few inhabitants on Midway, a few researchers. So this plastic does not originate on the island. It originates from us and from Asia. And it's found its way into the oceans because of our waste practices, and eventually finds its way washing up on shores all across the world and interacting with sea life in just some of the ways I've just scratching the surface here. And it's not just the birds or the mammals. The fish are starting to ingest these pieces of plastic that they're finding, either thinking it's food or believing that there's food on the pieces of plastic. And even if the fish survive with this plastic in their stomachs for some period of time, it turns out there's another problem that we just discovered. And the problem on the surface, when I first heard about it, I said, well, this is a good problem. It turns out that the plastics in the ocean break up into small fragments, and then they begin acting like little sponges. The plastics are hydrophobic, which means they don't like water, they like oil. The plastics that are floating, because it's largely polyethylene, polypropylene. Many of the contaminants that we've dumped in the ocean over the years are oil-based, hydrophobic in nature, like DDT and PCBs. They're preferentially concentrating on the plastic. The plastic are acting like little sponges for some of these toxins. And I thought, wow, first time I heard this, that's great. Let's go sweep up all the plastic and they will have cleaned up the ocean. The trouble is we haven't figured out how to get all the plastic out of the ocean, particularly before the fish eat it and ingest it. And then that gets reabsorbed into the fish, and then, of course, we eventually eat some of the fish. So even if none of these, and I'm sure everyone in the audience was moved by the earlier pictures, but even if it didn't bother you that some wildlife is having a bad interaction with our plastic waste habits, it is now coming back on our dinner plates, for those of you that eat fish. Now, if you don't eat fish, I know some of you in the audience are too young for this, but some of you might drink beer or other drinks. I just happen to have a study on beer. It just came out, I think, about a month or so ago. They tested, this is in Germany, and Germany has these very strict beer brewing laws. I think there's only four ingredients that can go in German beer, very strict. They tested the top 10 beers in Germany. Every single beer they tested had plastic microbeads in it. Now, they were doing ultrafiltration. These are very, very tiny particles. But the point is, it's showing up everywhere, and it's largely, again, due to our poor waste management practices over the years. So 20 years ago, well, I entered the plastics industry 35 years ago. I guess I'm telling my age. You didn't have to get 1 year I graduated. I've been in this industry a long time, and when I started, it wasn't because of the Dustin Hoffman movie, but it was a cool material. It was a space-age material. It was one of the coolest materials on the planet at the time, and you could do so many wonderful things with it. But of course now, ending up in the wrong places, it's not doing so many wonderful things. So can we begin looking at trash differently? There's actually people in many parts of the developing world that make a living off of trash heaps. The plastic are the one part of the trash heap they haven't figured out how to harvest in large amounts because it is difficult to harvest that material. So I said there's got to be a high-tech solution that's very robust. And literally 25 years or so ago, I started trying to figure out how to do it. I said there's got to be a better way to make plastics than from petrochemicals. It's going to be more sustainable, both from the environmental sense and from the economic sense. If we can start with waste instead of oil, it's plentiful and its cost is not tied to oil, at least not directly. And if we can do it without a big chemical plant, like we make most of our plastics, instead if we could use a mining type of approach where we use mechanical recycling techniques, we can do it at a much lower capital cost. We can save 80 to 90% of the energy. Our plants consume only 10 to 20% of the energy compared to a petrochemical plastic plant. And we have a more flexible plant. When you build a new plastic plant today, you're going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars. That plant will only make one type of plastic for its entire life. It can never make another type of plastic. my plants can make any type of plastic I feed them because they're just separating what's already been made. And the other breakthrough we managed to accomplish after over 20 years was to be able to make a drop-in replacement for virgin, a one-to-one. We save 3 to 4 tons of CO2 for every ton of virgin plastic we replace. Our customers get to close the loop and they get to make more sustainable products. I'm going to walk you through and talk you through a 90-second video. You can find out more about our company and process online. I don't want to spend too much time on that, but just to give you a sense for what's possible. To go from garbage, so this is what happens to your car. Again, it gets shredded in 10,000 horsepower shredders to the size of your hand in 20 seconds. The metals are recovered. What's left is largely plastic, foam, carpeting, wood, glass, paper, cardboard, occasional dead animals that get in the shredder. And that's what we get. That becomes our feed. And if we didn't get it, it would be burned or go into a landfill. The first part of our process, this is what I call the Willy Wonka part of our process. It's separating the stuff that's plastic away from the non-plastic and doing it through traditional recycling techniques, some of which we developed ourselves. We end up with a plastic mixture at the end of that process that's 20 or 30 different types of plastic. We grind it to about the size of your fingernail, and the high-tech part of our process separates it particle, by type, by grade, and by color. Out the back end of our process comes little plastic flakes that are one type, one grade. This has not yet been color sorted. Once it's been color sorted, it goes into big silos where we homogenize it. It then goes into spaghetti-like making machines where we make strands of plastic in a machine very much like a spaghetti making machine. These strands of plastic are cooled in water and they're cut into little pellets, and this is the currency of the plastic industry. If you went to a virgin plastics company, this is exactly what you would buy from them, these little pellets. And not only are we able to transform some of the most complex waste streams in the world into new plastics going into new products, we're doing it on a global scale because we have to. Our customers are international. Started the company in California, but we built our first two world-scale plants in China and Austria roughly at the same time. So at that point in time, we were about a 20-person company, and this about killed the company back in 2006 because we didn't speak the language, we didn't know the cultures. We were trying to build our first two world-scale plants almost simultaneously in two different parts of the world. I don't know what we were thinking. Well, we were thinking we had an opportunity, so let's grab it. It about killed us, but we managed to pull out, and now they're huge plants recycling, each of them recycling almost 100 million pounds a year. Our biggest plant is in the UK, and that's our most recent, and I'll step you through what they look like, at least from the outside. Again, if you go to our website, you can learn more about what each of these plants do. The one in China is in Guangzhou, China, which is the heart of the electronics manufacturing industry, because that's where many of our customers have their products made. We're in Austria. Austria, everyone asks me, why in the world are you in Austria? Well, Austria sits right between the largest consumption part in Europe, which is Western Europe, and where a lot of the stuff is being manufactured, which is in Eastern Europe. So we're taking a lot of the waste from Western Europe, we're harvesting the material, upgrading it, and sending it to Eastern Europe for reuse of new products. And we're in the UK because we have a joint venture with the largest metal recycler, and we take all their waste. So one recycler is able to provide us with enough waste for our biggest plant. And this plant will eventually recycle about 150 million pounds a year of plastic. This plant also is the most sophisticated, all of our plants are the most sophisticated plastics recycling plants on the planet because we're handling the most complex waste streams. But this one is unique in that it's handling waste from automobiles, electronics, and household waste. The same stuff you put in your recycle bin or the plastic, when your bin breaks at home or your toys break, et cetera. This plant processes that as well. So now instead of your plastics ending up on a hillside in a developing country or literally up in smoke, you can find them back at work on your desktop. And these are just examples of a few of our customers that are using our plastics 100% to replace virgin or new plastics. These are Hewlett-Packard printers. We also sell to Lexmark. Electrolux is an example of one of our home appliance customers, and they're so proud of using recycled plastics, they actually mold it right on the product. They say 70% recycled plastics, and that's made possible by us. And we're even in coffee machines. So far, not in any hot water contact, just in the cosmetic parts of the machines. And these are just, again, a few of the examples. So now I'd like to end up at least this part of the talk where I began. with your stuff again. And I have to give my daughter airtime because I gave my son airtime on the beginning. This was quite a few years ago because she's 14 now.
But I like the t-shirt,
Listen to Your Mama, because that's kind of how we started the company. It was trying to mimic what Mother Nature does, which wastes nothing, reuses practically everything. And I'd like to revisit that last toddler rule just a little bit, and I'd like to change it with your permission. So now if it's broken, just think of it as being my stuff. So what I'd like to wrap up with is trying to answer this question. Does anyone really care about this? Because this is a question that's bugged me for a very long time. I felt that I was doing all this hard work, and yeah, my investors cared, and I cared, and my team cared, and some of our customers cared, but I felt like it was a very small universe. And my mind's changed in the last 5 years, and let me give you some of the reasons why there's hope out there. I think more and more people are caring all the time about this issue and many others, but right now I'm talking about this one. One thing that's driving them is the movement towards green procurement. Now, I don't know if any of you recognize any of these labels. Many of these are green labels, and many of them are in Europe, because Europe has figured this out long before we did, that a circular economy is better than a linear economy. The one at the top, however, is EP. How many of you are familiar with the LEED standard, L-E-E-D, for buildings? So it's a standard for green buildings. I'm sure you have some here in Boston. EP is modeled after LEED, except it's for electronics. So it's about 56 different attributes that has to do with toxic materials going into the products. Do they have a recycling scheme for the product, using recycled materials in the products, and so forth, Energy Star, et cetera, in the product. And we were instrumental in making sure that a recycled plastic content was part of the standard. And now, why does this matter? Well, it matters because big procurement organizations around the world, including the U.S. government, has said they will only buy EP-certified products. So if you're a Hewlett-Packard or a Dell, and you want to sell to the U.S. government your product, it must be EP-certified. And to be EP-certified, you have to meet many criteria, including using recycled materials and providing for recycled schemes at the end of life of your products. So these types of standards are changing the behavior of the manufacturers of the stuff we make, and it's helping businesses like us get a stake in the ground. Other companies have figured out that the ocean plastic is something that people are starting to become aware of as being an issue, and they're trying to, if not solve it, at least draw attention to it. How many of you are familiar with Method? It's the clean cleaner. So this fits very much with their mission as a company. They make cleaners that are made out of very environmentally sensitive materials, or very environmentally positive materials. And they've now created one bottle that they call their ocean plastic bottle, made literally out of plastic from the oceans. Now, they're not making a big dent in the ocean plastic problem because they're collecting it from one spot in Hawaii, and they're blending it with virgin plastic in order to get the properties they need, but they're using it to draw attention to the problem. And they're very open and honest about that. Their mission is to say, look, there's a problem out here, we all need to work on it, we're trying to both draw attention to it and do our tiny little bit to try to help start solving it. Electrolux, the same. I mentioned them earlier. They have a program called Back from the Sea, where they took ocean plastics and actually made, they covered some of their vacuum cleaners with the ocean plastics, which are quite beautiful artworks. Again, they were very open and honest and said, look, we're not going to be able to make vacuum cleaners harvest or using plastics harvested from the sea anytime soon, but we want to draw attention to the problem, number one. And number two, we're working with this company called NBA Polymers to make our commercial vacuum cleaners, the one in the lower left, the black one, out of recycled plastic, as much recycled materials as we can, to help provide a market for this material so it doesn't end up in the oceans. Rock stars have gotten into this. I have to admit, I had to ask my daughter who in the world was Pharrell Williams. The young people in the crowd will just laugh at me because they know who he is. For those of you that also don't know who Pharrell Williams is, the song Happy is probably one of his more famous songs. But what he's doing is he's trying to draw attention to the problem by saying, let's make designer wear from plastics from the oceans, PET bottles in particular, and let's make garments made from these PET fibers. Now, they're not the first company to do this by any means. Patagonia's been doing this for many, many years, for example. However, they're the first to really shine a light on the ocean plastic problem and say, this is their objective, is to shine a light on the problem. They're not going to solve the problem by making apparel out of recycled plastic, but they're going to shine a light on the problem and maybe be a tiny part of the solution. In the same vein, Will.i.am, another rock star these days, is working with Coca-Cola and 3D Systems to talk about using recycled plastic to make new, cool stuff. And I'm working both with Coke and 3D Systems to try to take it to another level instead of just artistic objects, to actually show that it can actually be made into, you know, maybe more useful objects that we use every day. I want to show you just a few of the accolades that MBA Polymers has received, and it's not to brag about MBA Polymers, or maybe I should honestly say it's not just to brag about MBA Polymers. What I want to communicate to you is that there's a lot of major organizations out there that see this problem as significant, how we are treating waste as waste instead of a resource. And we've received a lot of recognition from a lot of leading organizations because they recognize that we can't treat waste as waste any longer. Waste is just resources that were used for their existing purpose, but they have to be used as a resource again because we can't keep mining the earth for those resources. So we've received recognition from the World Economic Forum, who would normally give it to, you know, other high-tech companies, the same for the Economist Award for Innovation, the same for the Intel Tech Laureate Award. I was able to share the stage with Bill Gates. Thomas Alva Edison Award for Innovation, and Tim mentioned the Gothenburg Award, previous winners of Al Gore, Kofi Annan, etc. My point here is that leading organizations see resource management, waste management, as important to our future, to developing a sustainable future. And those resources, they're using their resources to help promote the idea of a more circular economy and closing the loop. But when it really came home for me, how many are familiar with TED Talks? I imagine a lot of you have watched TED Talks. I was always a big TED fan. And when TED came to me and said they'd like for me to give a talk, I was astonished first. Really? On what? And they said, well, plastics recycling, of course. I said, really? So that's not a typical TED topic. But I did. It turned out well. I was very happy to do it. And what I was more astonished about has been the reception to it worldwide. So it's seen a fair number of views. But more importantly, TED even came back to us and said, you know, you're up there, you're seeing your view rate is pretty good. But more importantly, you're probably seeing more comments than just about any talk we've ever seen. And they're comments along the lines of, how can I be part of this? Oh my gosh, I didn't know there were solutions. How can I have this in my part of the world? How can I have this in my community? I want to help solve this problem. So my point with this is, when you asked me this question, does anybody care 5 years ago, I would have said, well, it doesn't feel like it. It feels like there's very few people that care. But I have a completely different perspective of that. I think the problem was they just didn't, A, know about the problem, or even if they knew about the problem, they'd never dreamed that there were possible solutions to it. So I've had a very fortunate change of mind. And in fact, it's almost a snowball effect. CNN did a documentary on us just a few months ago. Popular Science did a feature earlier this year, an 8-page feature on what we're doing, how we're taking garbage to resources. And one for this community, since a lot of you are obviously learning, otherwise you wouldn't be spending your Thursday night here, the Jason Project is trying to communicate to kids that STEM learning can be exciting and lead to being able to do cool things. So STEM, for those of you who don't know STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, they're not always the subjects that kids want to learn. I know, even though I'm an engineer, they weren't always my favorite subjects in school. But I'm certainly glad I learned them because it allowed me to do what I do. So they're trying to bring it to life and make it interesting by telling stories of people that have followed STEM careers and are now doing cool things. I was lucky enough to be one of those stories, but they have a lot of other really cool stories out there, a lot of them around the ocean. So I encourage you to point your schools to this program. These are live interactions. Mine, for example, I gave, I think, a 20-minute talk, and then I had live questions from students all across the United States that were tuned into the program, and then they host them on the internet. So you can probably see 30 or so different of these programs, and it's all about
taking science, technology, engineering, and math training and doing really cool stuff with it. And what I want to end up with on the communication side, because I guess my biggest learning in the last 5 years, which I've already suggested, is that people out there really do care. We all care, right? I mean, you guys care for sure. You wouldn't, again, be spending your Thursday night here if you didn't care about some of these issues. But more people than you think probably care. They just don't know about the issues. They don't understand the issues, and they don't know that there's possible solutions to the issues. So a big part of what I've been trying to do over the last 4 to 5 years is getting the message out. That's why I'm here tonight, is trying to share the problems and the opportunities for solving those problems. And luckily, we've had a lot of resources, which I've tried to communicate here towards the end of the talk, thrown at us. And this is the last example I want to give you. I have to also admit I didn't know who Adrian Grenier was, but he's a fairly popular actor. And Peter Glatzer is a producer. And they got together and said, look, there's a lot of people doing cool stuff out there, but they don't have a way to communicate it because they don't have the budget or the know-how to do it, and they've got their heads down trying to solve problems. Let's shine a Hollywood light. We know how Hollywood works. We know how to shine a light on stories. Let's do that. So they created an organization called Shift, and they've got a website called Making Shift Happen. It's a shift in thinking. And then they also did this program called The Big Shift, and they found 10 innovators around the world in very many different spaces, in the food space, the water space, the waste space. And we were lucky enough to be the story they wanted to tell in the recycle space. And I just want to share that with you. And what they did is they sent a Hollywood crew, like 5 people, for like 15 hours they spent with us to produce a 3-minute documentary, because that's about all people have a time for these days. In fact, 3 minutes is long for many of you. So bear, those of you who are 3 minutes is long, sorry, it's a 3-minute documentary, but I think they did a good job and make it entertaining.
I'm a plastics nerd, I guess you could say. And I was working at the very high tech end of the plastics industry when it occurred to me, we're going to run out of stuff to make our stuff. There had to be a way to reuse these plastics. I went to the company I was working for, which was a big plastic chemical company, and I said, hey, I think we should look at recycling our plastics. The initial response I got back was, we didn't hire a PhD in plastics to work on garbage. So I decided I needed to go out on my own. The challenge of plastics with respect to recycling is that there are many different types and grades of plastics. The first real use of plastic was to replace ivory in billiard balls. It's called Bakelite. And from that, many different chemistries evolved: polyethylene, polystyrene, ABS, polypropylene. Now it's in just about everything we touch. But how do you separate all of those many different types and grades of plastics from one another so that they can be reused for a high quality purpose again? And that is the code, basically, we had to crack. We tested everything on the planet, and it took faith. It actually took faith because we didn't know how we were going to do it. You solve one problem and then you work on the next one. Wow, that actually worked. And then the next one and the next one. It took a number of different technologies, from food processing, metal manufacturing, from mining technology, combined together and tweaking them in different ways to force plastics to separate. But we're here now, and we've made it happen. We believe we're giving materials a new life. When I first started working on this, the recycle rate for plastics was less than 5% in the world. What a waste of valuable resources. 500 billion pounds of plastics consumed in the world each and every year. And we have to drill another oil well to get the petrochemicals to make the plastics. What comes out the end of our process is a little plastic pellet that's ready to go right back into a new computer or car part. We are clearly in need of innovation, of technologies that use our precious natural resources more efficiently. we got to where we are today by building on ideas from many different people, many different parts of the world. And now, because we can share ideas so effectively today, we can build on those ideas. The person that ran the U.S. Patent Agency at one time made the proclamation, we're done. Everything that's important that to have been invented has been invented. And of course, that was about 100 years ago. I wanted to do something to preserve the Earth. This is literally a dream come true, to be able to do something I believe in, that matters to me, and trying to spread it around the world.
So I wanted to share that with you partly to communicate that good communication about problems and solutions is important. I think the other lesson that I learned in this 20-year plus journey and $150 million worth of investment is that there's a lot of help out there if you'll just ask for it and if you can explain your problems simply and in compelling ways and not present it just as problems. Presented as potential for solutions. I'm eager to help you solve your waste solutions, turn your waste into resources. You can reach me at that email address, and I'm also learning Twitter, so I'm reasonably active on Twitter and trying to get more in tune with social media of the day. So happy to engage with you in any way I can. And also happy to answer any questions you might have. So I hope that there's some out there. Thank you. There's one in the back. That's great. So the questions were, do we have to deal with toxic materials in our plastics? And secondly, how has green chemistry taken hold? Has it taken root here in the U.S. and beyond? I answered the first question. So I alluded to toxins getting in plastics by absorbing them from the oceans, not being in the plastics originally. And that is indeed happening. The toxics you're probably referring to, and I'll put it in quotes, are legacy additives. Again, so not knowing about some of the additives that we were using in the early days, we put things like cadmium and lead and polybrominated diphenyl ethers, that's a long word, which just means the brominated flame retardants, in plastics in order to get certain properties of the plastics. Most of those additives have been banned because we've learned that they're not good to put in plastics, particularly at the end of life and dealing with the end of life. So our process has to see those additives in the plastic. And we don't take those additives out because we're not a chemical process, but we have to identify each particle that has those additives in them and remove them from the plastics that don't have those additives in them. And that's not easy. That's part of the difficulty we had in rolling out the process on a commercial scale, but we do it. And we have to meet very strict regulations known as REACH and ROS that came out of Europe that regulate these legacy additives. So we are able to deal with those. It's not easy and it costs us money to do it, but we are able to manage that. Your second question on green chemistry, yes, green chemistry has taken a hold, particularly on the two coasts. I think I hail from San Francisco, so it's you hear a lot of green chemistry talk at Berkeley and Stanford. And I think here, as you say, here on the East Coast, it's actually, there's a big movement towards green chemistry, and I think it's starting to take hold in industry as well, not just because they want to do the right thing, but because not using complex molecules is actually more cost-effective, just like recycling is more cost-effective using the molecules again. So I think we're seeing better and better green chemistry. I think another thing that will drive that is a movement towards something called EPR, Extended Producer Responsibility. It's part of the same notion that you may have heard of circular economy,
or closing the loop or cradle-to-cradle thinking. More and more companies are adopting that. Either they're feeling the need to do that for standards or marketing reasons, and or they see the economic advantages of doing that, and green chemistry is part of that. If you have to be responsible for the products you make all the way through the life cycle, in other words, when they come back, guess what? You're going to make them easier to recycle, less toxic. You might even make them last longer. So that's, I think that's a very healthy movement. It's being resisted by many companies, but I still see more and more companies embracing it all the time. Yes?
We have I live in a city north of Boston. We have a pretty, I would say, good recycling program, but I know for a fact that the products are being shipped, as you talked about, to China. Is there an alternative route that a local community could suggest for those products to take?
It's a great question. Thank you for asking it, because it's one near and dear to my heart. So yes, so you do recycling in Boston. I'm sure you do. I know you do. Much of the stuff you recycle, some of it is recycled domestically for sure, particularly the ones and twos that are sorted out using near-infrared sorters and a combination of near-infrared and humans to get the final quality. And that is largely consumed domestically. The difficult to recycle plastics is largely, not entirely, but largely shipped overseas. And much of it actually is processed in the ways I showed you. So are there alternatives domestically? That's a great question. The reason that there aren't isn't because the technology doesn't exist, because it clearly does, and it's not just our company. It's because for me to build a plant here in the U.S., I need a secure feedstock. And the waste management companies, before they'll put in the material recycling facility that I talked about that takes your single stream, your mixed recycled bin, and sorts out the commodities, the metals, the paper, the glass, the plastics, and the plastics they may even sort by ones and twos, and then the mixed plastics. The company that does that usually requires, before they put in that facility, because it may cost $10 or more million, they require a 10 to 20 year supply agreement with the community, typically. But that same company will not sign a long-term supply agreement with recyclers like us, at least not yet. That's starting to change, but until they do that, for the same reason they wouldn't build that facility, they wouldn't spend the tens of millions of dollars to build their facility, we can't do the same, because if they continue to ship it to lower cost operations that don't have all the environmental costs and human and worker safety costs, there's no way a local recycler can compete. That's starting to change, not because of U.S. policy or state policy. It's changing because China has recently erected what they call a green fence and said, stop dumping on us, stop sending us your garbage, because they see the same problem. Now, that slowed it down for a while, but then of course, markets opened up in Africa, Malaysia, Thailand, et cetera. It's always going to the lowest cost denominator. So until the U.S. gets on board, like most developed countries have, and say we either want domestic recycling because we know it will be done responsibly, or at least we want to know that where you're shipping it to, it's being done at least by the local regulations, being done somewhat responsibly in other countries. Canada has those regulations in place. Most of Europe and large parts of Asia have those regulations in place. The U.S., as in many environmental policy, is way behind the times. And that's, unfortunately, we're quite comfortable shipping our waste overseas, not knowing how it's going to be handled. Sure.
If you had to pick a country that had a problem similar to ours, that you've just described, that would be a good example to follow in order to make that happen, which one?
Well, look where my plants are. So the question was, what country should we follow? So I developed the technology here in the U.S. I'm a U.S. citizen. I'm angry is probably too calm of a word to say that we don't have these facilities in the U.S., but I can't, as a business person, do it until I have security of supply. Europe, because of their waste policies, two things. Europe has done two things we haven't. And it's not just Europe, but Europe's a good example. They first said, you can't throw your electronics away. You can't throw your cars away. They have to be recycled a certain way. They have to be recycled responsibly. And you can't even throw your household waste, quote, away. They have to be handled responsibly. So that was the first thing they did. Some states in the U.S. do that. And to be honest, most of our cars are recycled in the United States. And some of our electronics are recycled. A lot of it is shipped overseas still. But the second thing that they've done that we are far from doing is saying, and if you
create commodities from those recycling activities and you ship them overseas, they have to go to responsible recyclers overseas or they have to stay domestic. And it's not a trade barrier, it's just saying, it's just being honest, frankly. It's saying, I wouldn't want that processing in my backyard, why should I dump on it, literally dump my waste on another country where I'm pretty sure it's not going to be handled properly. So U.S. is one of the last countries in the world to own up to that. Just a couple, two more examples along the same lines that will kind of maybe put a sharper point on it. Almost every single developed country in the world, and even India and China, and I think they're developed countries these days, have an e-waste policy, a national e-waste policy. The U.S. is the only developed country in the entire world that does not have a national electronics waste policy. We're also the only developed country in the world, I believe, that has not ratified the Basel Convention. The Basel Convention says we won't dump our waste on developing countries, non-OECD countries. So until the U.S. takes responsibility, until we take responsibility for our waste streams, it's going to be hard to stop that flow of materials. And we're the biggest waste generators in the world per capita. So we need to take responsibility for our waste streams.
Well, it seems like the root cause of plastics is the consumer. What is being done to have the consumer actually play a part in stopping waste going into the waste stream and
right.
not buying things they don't need?
Right. Yeah, so she asked, it seems like the root cause is the consumer, and I guess to some extent it is. I mean, we still have to consume some things, right? And in my TED Talk, a few of you said you saw my TED Talk, which there's some of the slides from my TED Talk. I have a slide in there that I didn't have in here, a piece where I say I hate the word consumer. I think it's a horrible word because it means we destroy. And I don't think we should think of, if we're taught to think of that way. We're taught of consuming, right? Finish with it and then it goes away. And I still don't know where away is except in the oceans or in the ground. So consumption is a problem, but consumption is never going to go to zero. So it's not going to completely solve the problem. We have to deal with our waste streams. And maybe to answer your question more directly, yes, and I think you could see in a few of the slides, the answer from the people that are very concerned about this is, well, maybe the answer is to stop using plastic. Well, that's not practical, right? It's not going to happen. We might not use it in certain applications. We just have to be more responsible for what we do with this thing when we're done with it, or make it out of something else. I mean, this is how I travel. It's a metal bottle, even though I'm a plastics guy. It's not that hard to change your behavior, but I still, quote, consume. This will eventually die. My car will eventually die. My computer eventually dies. And I try to make sure I know where it goes after it's dead. So it's not really dead. It's just going to be reused again in another way. Yes?
Mike, I'm an old guy. From Rachel Carson to the transformative Clean Water and Clean Air Acts was about 7 years. It's been 20 years. Nobody's angry. You're doing some innovative stuff. What happened?
That's a good question. So Rachel Carson, I guess, had an effect. I don't know the history, but 7 years, I'll take your word for it. I've been at this 20 years. Well, I think we've had a pretty big impact. It just hasn't been in the United States, unfortunately.
Why hasn't it happened in this country?
It's business. It's it is cheaper for a waste management company. In the long term, it's not cheaper because my plants make money. But maybe they didn't believe it initially, but now they're starting to believe it. So I think maybe that'll be part of it. The proof's in the pudding. Come look at the plants; they actually make money. But a waste company can make pretty good money by charging you to collect your waste at your curbside, barely doing anything to it. MRF is a very simple recycling facility. I don't know if any of you, I encourage you to go visit MRF sometimes to see what happens to your waste. It's not very sophisticated, but they do a decent job of making mostly paper, mostly metal, mostly glass, mostly plastic bales that they then ship to somewhere where they're actually processed. That's a pretty good business model. You pay them to collect it, you pay them to process it, and then they get paid for these bales of stuff. It's a lot cheaper than building a factory, or it's a short-term way to make a lot of money. And it takes a big investment to do what we've done. And I think we'll see the first waste company, I hope, within the next few years in the U.S. say, wow, this does make a lot more economic sense. It's not just an environmental thing to do. But I can't say that it's with certainty that will happen, but I am more optimistic, let's say, that we'll start to see the same type of plants that we have overseas here in the U.S. And but it's not just about our plants showing up in the U.S. I think it's a whole change of thinking, and it kind of gets to the earlier question about how we consume things. And when you put it in a garbage can, instead of thinking of it as waste, I can tell you, I've lived in Europe too, and they look at that behavior differently. They more, on average, people think of that as a resource, and they think it's going to be recovered. Whereas I think most of us still think, well, I put it in there and it just goes away somewhere in a landfill, or maybe it's recycled. So until we start thinking about our stuff differently, I don't think it's going to take hold. Which is part of the reason why the last part of my talk is all about communication and talking about why it's important to change mindset. That's a slow process. I know it's not an answer to your question, but it's if I had the answer, I probably wouldn't be standing here. I'd be out busy building plants. Yes.
And just going to changing mindsets, you have a lot of students here today.
Right.
And I just want to make sure we're quoting the small companies that you mentioned, like Plastic Pollution Coalition and Surfrider. They're not really saying that you shouldn't use plastics. They're saying that you should refuse single-use plastic,
right,
like straws and cups and things like that. And I think that you know, we walk away here today thinking there's nothing that can be done. And, you know, I think that people need to realize that they can have an impact by refusing the single-use plastics and thinking,
yeah,
about what they are consuming.
Exactly. And I'll just give, she said we got to stop. Many of the organizations that I said that are showing, you know, stop using plastics, to be honest, one of them that she mentioned is don't use plastics,
right,
at their heart.
Right,
I know them very well.
Deanna, right, yeah.
But yes, you're right. It's about single-use plastics and changing that behavior. And it is starting to take hold. And I mean, of course, my daughter's a little brainwashed having to live in the same house with me, but she's better than I am. She refuses. If we go to a restaurant and they try to give her a straw, she forces them to take it back. She just won't even take it. Or a reason she wouldn't have accepted this cup. When we go to a yogurt station, she insists on bringing our own spoon and our own bowl to fill up at the yogurt station. I mean, that's a little extreme, but it's cool, right? She's thinking, look, if we bring our own bowl and we consume it, then we bring the bowl back. There is no waste, right? There's, you know. So it's possible. It is possible to change your behavior. You just have to, you know, you have to think about it. You have to make a change. Yes?
So you have a pretty familiar story. You were a young chemist at a well-established industry company who was frustrated with, I guess, was the environment of it, or the uncreative environment of it, and left. So my question to you is, what if a young chemist at MBA Polymers came to you,
right,
and said, I want to start looking into bio-based materials and bio-based plastics?
Right.
What's your response to him or her? And what do you see as the future of that industry?
So two parts. I just need to repeat it for others. So the first was, okay, I left a big company and to start my own company because I didn't like necessarily what we were doing, or I thought maybe there was a better way to do it. And what would I do if one of my employees came to me with a similar question and it was about bio-based plastics? So I'll take it in two parts. So first, I have encouraged a number of my employees to go off with their own dreams. In fact, one of them started a polyurethane recycling company, you know, the foam in these seats and your bedding material. So he started his own company because I said, no, I don't think we're going to do that. Go do it. And I've supported that work. So I think it's great. I think it's great when people come up with ideas and they're going to go charge forward with it. As far as bio-based plastics, which is maybe the heart of your question, how do I feel about bio-based plastics? Bio-based plastics is a large term for plastics made from biomaterials. And biomaterials can include food. The most common bioplastic is PLA, which is mostly made from corn, made by a company called NatureWorks, I know very well. Bioplastics can also mean plastics made from waste carbon, like CO2 and methane. So there's three companies that I'm aware of, four maybe, that are trying to make plastics from waste CO2 from manufacturing operations, or waste methane even from landfill gases. So keeping it from becoming a really nasty greenhouse gas, making a plastic out of that gas, which is pretty cool. And that can be called a biopolymer too, because it's kind of not really bio, but it's coming from the degradation of biomaterials. Or it can come from food waste and so forth, or waste products. I think that's great. If you can show that you can do that more cost effectively and environmental total life cycle effectively, Of course, you should do that. I mean, that's a good way to make plastics. Within a subset of bioplastics is biodegradable plastics. Now, biodegradation sounds great because you can imagine it solving some of these marine problems. The trouble with biodegradable plastics or biodegradable anything is that it reinforces that one-way notion. So to make, let's take PLA for example. So to make, if this were made out of PLA, in fact it might be, can't really see, but let's say it is made out of PLA. It makes a fine plastic, and but if I put it in the compost, instead of reusing these molecules, I have to then regrow the corn, I have to fertilize it, I have to harvest it, and then I have to extract the chemical from that plant. And now I'm at the same starting point as a virgin plastic. And then I have to make the plastic, and now I'm at the same starting point as recycling it. So from a life cycle standpoint, it's much better to keep the molecules in play than having them turn to dust or soil. Even though biodegradation sounds wonderful, and I think for certain applications it's absolutely the right answer, but it's not the be-all, end-all. Because it doesn't make sense from a life cycle assessment, and most NGOs are on board with that and actually put a lot of pressure on the companies like NatureWorks, and now instead of talking about biodegradability, they're talking about recycling, and they've created a recycle stream for their material, or scheme for their material, because it is a better life cycle to keep the molecules in play. Is that?
Oh, that's very good.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Yes. Okay, so she's asked about the microbeads, and are you referring to microbeads specifically? There is a class of plastics called microbeads, like in facial scrubs, is that what? In cosmetics. But also the plastics in the ocean often become microplastics because of photodegradation, getting smaller and smaller particles. So I think the heart of your question is, can we do anything with that? First, can we get it out of the ocean? If we can we do anything with it? So getting it out of the ocean is the big bugaboo. I've identified 50 or 60 companies around the world that are trying to solve that problem, trying to figure out how to get plastics out of the ocean. And they're all great people, hearts in the right places. You mentioned a few, but there's 50 or 60 organizations out there. So problem number one is they're competing for limiting resources. But they're all great trying to solve the problem. Most of them have decided that they're not going to be able to solve the problem of getting the plastics out of the ocean in the short term, and have instead focused their attention on keeping them out of the ocean in the first place, and stopping one-use plastics, one-way-use plastics, and also trying to figure out recycle schemes for the plastics so they don't ever reach the ocean, so there's a market for that waste. But the real question is, will we ever get it out of the oceans? I think we will. I think we'll figure out a way to do it. I don't know what the answer is yet. I've worked with a lot of brilliant people that haven't quite figured it out yet. It's hard because it's small. You hear about the plastic islands. Well, you actually go out in the ocean and there's a piece of plastic there, and go for a while, oh, there's another piece of plastic over here. It's not an island. There might be little pockets of islands, but it is a plastic soup. So within about a foot of the ocean, there's these microparticles that are floating, and if you drag a net behind, it doesn't take a long time to get a handful. But it takes a while to get a handful of plastic. So economically, it's tough to understand, but even technically, it's tough because you have to use such a fine net to get the microplastics that you're also getting a lot of sea life. And then you have to separate the plastic from the sea life. Will that ever be possible? Yes, I think it probably will be, but no one's quite figured it out yet economically or even technically, frankly, on how to do it on a large scale where it will make an impact. Once you get it back, I can tell you, I analyzed this plastic from many different gyres that people brought back to me. Can you recycle this? And the real answer is probably not. It doesn't make sense to recycle because it's been so degraded with photodegradation, that's why it's in small particles, that the properties of it are pretty poor. So the best use for it is probably to turn it to energy, in my opinion. And that's not the best use, but it's the best use for that plastic, probably. Beach plastic, even the method example where they get plastic from the beach, I'm sure we've all seen plastic on the beach. Sometimes you'll pick up a piece of plastic on the beach and it still feels plasticky or flexible. Other times you'll pick up another piece of plastic and it'll crumble in your hand, it'll be very brittle. And that piece of plastic's been exposed to UV radiation longer, and so it's degraded. that plastic has very poor properties when used again, because the molecular chains have gotten smaller and smaller. So what Method had to do on its beach plastic is blend it with about 80% virgin plastic to even be able to make a bottle. But again, they're still doing, it's great that they're doing it, they're trying to draw attention to the problem. But if when the plastic sits outside for a long time, it does degrade, it just takes a very long time to degrade. Do we get any plastics from the oceans yet? No, because no one's really collecting in large volumes. The largest volumes that I know of that are being collected today are along shorelines or beach cleanups, and even those are, you know, a ton here, a ton there. We do 10 tons an hour at our plants for economies of scale, and that's still small compared to a virgin plant. We're like 10% the size of a typical virgin plant.
Yes. Related question, what's preventing manufacturers from using more recycled plastics? I mean, you just gave that one example that, you know, the properties might be an issue, but are there other reasons?
What's preventing more companies from using recycled plastics? Well, I think I showed we have quite a few customers, Fortune 100 customers that are using recycled plastic. I'll tell you the story of steel because it'll help tell the story. So 30 years ago, I don't know if I have my decades right, I might be off by a decade. It was commonly believed that you could never recycle steel, you could never upcycle steel back to similar applications. It would always be used in rebar, which it still is to a large extent, reinforcing. In fact, I'm sure this building has a lot of rebar, recycled steel in it. But the technology got good enough where you could now use recycled steel in everything.
Yeah, I'm sure there's recycled steel in this microphone. There's recycled steel all over your car.
And that just took time to get the technology, and that's kind of what we've done. We've gone from downcycling to upcycling with plastic. So companies are using it. Beach plastic and ocean plastic, because it's set outside for a long time, it has degraded. And if you don't do high-end recycling like we do, you will also have inferior properties and do downcycling like they do in developing countries, largely. I don't want to say that there's no high-tech recycling going on in developing countries, but largely it's informal recycling with low-quality materials. So a typical customer is not, they're only going to want to make kind of very inexpensive toys, the kind of toys that break when they fall on the ground, or they're going to want to make, you know, throwaway items from it. So just like steel, the technology has now evolved by us and other companies so that we can recycle plastics right back to a high level. And it's just a natural evolution over time. Yes. The lifespan of our recycled products. So many people ask, and probably embedded in your question is, how many times do you use plastic again and again? So you can recycle plastic many, many times, as long as we've done our job right. The three main things we have to do right is we have to get the non-plastics away from the plastics. And additionally, we have to separate the different plastics by type and by grade. We have to make sure that the plastic is dried sufficiently before we melt it, because some plastics, if you melt them in the presence of moisture or too much moisture, they will degrade. And we have to make sure that we haven't exposed them to too high temperatures. Any of those three things we get wrong, we can degrade the plastics and lower the properties and get inferior materials. So as long as we do those three things right, the plastics can last a very long time. Now, maybe your question was how long will this, for example, this plastic cup last if I set it outside? If it sees the sun, it would probably take years before it would actually crumble. And the way it would crumble would be in smaller and smaller and smaller particles. It would take a very, very long time to completely disintegrate. And it depends on the type of plastic. Some plastics will degrade more quickly on environmental exposure. The most prominent way that plastics degrade is with UV degradation from sunlight. Yes.
In both there is definitely an interest in recycling, but a lot of recyclers will not take back things like the plastic packaging we talked about.
Right.
Or like purple and the wrap.
Right.
Which has specific requirements for recycling. So there's over 5,000 hospitals in the United States, and they can't recycle all this recycled material. Have you heard anything, I guess, in the industry with regard to
right. She asked about hospital plastics, right? And I'll put it into two classes. So there's the contaminated, if you will, hazard, biohazard, hospital plastics, and those typically go, they have to be sterilized before they can either be reused, but more often than not, they're incinerated or destroyed because they have because of the biohazard potential. There are also plastics, quite a bit of plastics in packaging and so forth in hospitals that don't have a biohazard issue. It's usually a volume issue with the local waste company, and film plastic, which a lot of it is film or thin-walled, is difficult to recycle, not technically, but economically, because you have a lot of surface area to mass. It's hard to transport, it's expensive to transport, it's expensive to wash, it's expensive to dry, because you have so much surface, and that's why film recycling has been a challenge. And most film recycling ends up in plastic lumber, so that could be a potential application. That's mostly film plastic. If it's rigid plastic, and by rigid plastic I mean sort of like this cup and thicker walls, there's many recyclers like ourselves that can recycle that, and it could go into a mixed plastic waste stream. Now, in the United States, that would mean it's likely going to be eventually shipped overseas, and it may or may not be pulled out by a human for recycling. It may end up in the ocean, frankly.
Okay. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Tremendous.
Great questions. Thank you.
So thank you again, everyone, for coming, and keep an eye out on our website.
February. I think the
announced
next
February or the first lecture?
They'll start again in February.
Late winter, we'll start again on our, or early spring if you're an optimist. Our lectures will start again. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.